Black Ink Black Ale from Brazen Hall Brewing, specifically brewed for the Winnipeg Tattoo Show back in February. Look for fruity flavors on a subtle dark malt base, it says. So today I thought I would play with a couple of different moisture sensors, soil moisture sensors that I've accumulated. One that I received fairly recently in a mailbag, and one that I've had kicking around for quite a while. Actually, I've got two or three of them in here. So the basic difference between the two of them is this one operates on a resistive principle. So the chip on here is an LM393, which is a dual op amp. One side of that op amp is set up as an amplifier to amplify the voltage that's coming from the sensor. The voltage developed across the sensor and these resistors here, acting as a voltage divider. Anyway, it's amplifying that voltage and sending it out to A0, but it's also sending that voltage to the other half of the op amp, which is set up as a comparator. And this little pot here sets the threshold of that comparator. And when the comparator goes high, it sends this digital pin here high and also lights, which LED? One of these two LEDs. Anyway, indicating that you've crossed some sort of a threshold, which is all well and good. The only downside of this one is, since there is a current flowing across it through the liquid and whatever minerals are in the soil, there's a galvanic reaction happens and one or the other of these cruds up, starts corroding and oxidizing and stuff. So that's not ideal. There's ways you can get around it. One of them is to only give this thing power when you want to make a reading. So if we give this thing 5 volts, yeah, it's drawing negligible current. Okay, so you might be able to power that thing from the Arduino directly, from a digital pin, or you might be able to, it might be safer to power or control it from a digital pin, but power it through a transistor. But that would be one way of reducing the effect of that that corrosion. Not eliminating it, but reducing it down to just, you know, a few seconds every 10 minutes or 15 minutes or however often you want to read that thing. So that's one way of getting around it. Another thing I'm wondering is if you could put some sort of a conductive but non-water soluble coating on there, something like a petroleum jelly or something like that, perhaps something that would be relatively non-toxic to plants. I don't know. Has anybody played with that? Anyway, so that's the downside of that one. It's cheap and it seems to work fairly well, I think, except for that one downside. The other one is this capacitive soil sensor, which I just received a few weeks ago. Now it, as you can see, the parts that go into the soil, which is basically below, everything below that white line there, is completely coated with solder mask, yeah, or ink or paint or something, some kind of coating. Anyway, so that is not going to suffer that galvanic action. Plus, there's no current flowing between them. It is basically acting like two plates of a capacitor there and there. And these two plates of the capacitor are acting as a timing capacitor for this little 555 timer chip here. This one I've actually found a schematic for. I tried tracing it out by hand, but too many of the traces disappear under things, and yeah, it was a bit of a pain in the ass. So I have found a schematic. The schematic was conveniently on DF Robot's website, them being the originator of this thing. This schematic is the version 1 board. I've got the version 2, so it's slightly different, but not enough that it matters for what we're doing. So first of all, there is a little voltage regulator on there dropping the incoming 5 volts down to 3.3 volts, or 3 volts, which powers the rest of this circuit. This 555 is basically set up as an oscillator. There's the timing components there. These three components here. The capacitive element, the actually measuring element, one side of it is grounded. That's the part that wraps around the outside. And the piece that runs up the center, I've traced it out and it connects right there. The other side of the diode. Right there. So there's the oscillator is putting out a fairly high frequency. We'll measure that in a second. Through this resistor, and then so as the capacitance changes, as the moisture changes, the capacitance between that point and ground is going to change, which is going to mess with the square wave that's coming out of there again, I guess. And after that, the square wave gets rectified and smoothed by this and sent out as a DC voltage. So by that capacitance changing, I guess it's going to dampen down that frequency, like dampen down the amplitude of that frequency. Yeah, that makes a certain amount of sense. Okay, let's just power this thing up and play with it for a minute here. First, we'll look at the resistive sensor. We've got power on it, and we got one light on and one light off. And when I put some moisture across there, using my soldering sponge, there you notice that that comes on. Now that my fingers are a little bit wet, so that's just hitting that threshold. So that's nothing super fancy. You could do that with anything conductive, like a screwdriver tip or something. That's okay, I guess. Let's take a look at the variable voltage on there. Okay, so now with a voltmeter connected, we're getting almost 5 volts out of it, and when it gets wet, it goes down to almost nothing. What happens if it's something slightly resistive? Maybe a slightly damp piece of paper, rather than a completely saturated one. Okay, so with just a slightly damp thing. And there you can see, I'm just pushing harder to make it become in more contact. And there are thresholds about 2.7 or so volts. Okay, so it can discern some things. That's interesting enough. Let's try the capacitive one now. So same setup, 5 volts coming in here. But remember, this thing has that little 3-volt regulator on it right there. So its range is from 0 to 3.5 volts. And right now, it's... let's put it in free space here. It's reading 2.49 volts. Okay, let's use our slightly damp piece of paper here. That's also going to have my fingers influencing it, though, because it's capacitive. Let's put a piece of wood in here. Okay, so as I vary my pressure on there again, it starts dropping. That's interesting. And how about the completely saturated soldering sponge? So 0.94, 0.95 is as low as it goes. Okay, so that tells me that this one doesn't have quite as wide a range. But that may not matter, because it's going to be more durable. So let's see how we can use this with an Arduino. For this experiment, I'm going to be using a couple of these Arduino Nano, I think they call them Arduino Nano Terminal Shield version. Two of them, they are identical, and I'll be using two of these little OLEDs to display our results. Okay, I think that's everything connected. So these are both basically the same, they're exactly the same setup. I've got the OLED connected on both of them. I've got the sensors connected on a zero of both of them. Okay, we're all set up here. I've got just a simple bit of code in both of them, and exactly the same code too. Both powered off battery banks. And it's kind of unfortunate that that's scrolling, but what are you going to do? Notice this one is showing 1023 for completely dry on this guy. And that one is showing 651. 650, 651, 660 something. We've got it up in free air. Basically for completely dry. And remember, this one is 3.3 volts and this one's 5 volts. And that makes sense for 5 volts. So if we put my slightly damp piece of paper towel onto this one, you can see it drops down fairly significantly. Put it onto this one. See, it starts moving a little bit, but it's moving fairly slowly. Let's put that saturated soldering sponge on there. And it drops a lot quicker. And further, but it's still not going to drop all the way down to zero. Why? I don't know exactly. But it keeps going as that capacitor is slowly doing whatever it's doing. If I completely wrap that in the sponge. So it's still dropping. It's not quite as fast to respond, it looks like. So we can, in the software, if we choose to, do a bit of scaling so that goes a little bit closer to that full 1023 scale. And we don't have to, we can just do the math based on that, right? But either way, it's not going to be that hard to work with in code, assuming, you know, you're okay at doing code. But let's scale it a little bit so that it looks more like that one, just so that we can compare the two of them when we take them and actually stuff them in some dirt later. So here's the code that I threw into those two nanos. It's mostly just ripped straight out of the Adafruit library for the OLED. So this stuff up here is all straight out of the library. And I pulled a whole bunch of stuff out to make room. Not just because I didn't need it. This is this stuff here straight from the library. The bit that I did, I created a couple of variables and do an analog read. And then here's some more stuff from the library with a slight modification. And I just print out the measurement and then wait a second and do it again. Nothing to it. Even somebody who's hopeless at coding like me can do this. So that's what you saw just now. And here's the one that I've modified to work with the capacitive sensor. Not that it wasn't working before. I just wanted, like I said, a little bit wider scale range. So all I did was add another variable in here and then use the map function to spread it out from the lowest and highest values that I observed playing with it up to that 1023 range that that 0 to 5 volts would normally be, and then printed that out. Nothing to it. Okay, so now hopefully this thing will show a much higher volume. That's interesting. So it's, well, it's showing a higher value anyway. It's not going all the way up to the 1023. And then when I get it slightly damp, it starts dropping. And when I get it really wet, it should go down really low here. Yeah, okay. And when this one gets wet, it drops down really low too. Okay. So those both seem to work. It's currently evening, so I'm not going to go out and play with these in the dirt right this second. But what I will do, there's one thing that I wanted to check on this one, is the oscillation of that thing. I have a sneaking suspicion, I didn't do the math, but just based on the component values, I think that's a fairly high value, fairly high speed of oscillation on there. Okay, I've got my oscilloscope connected up now. I'm just going to measure pin 3 here, which is the output pin of that 555. So if I put my markers on there, looks like it's about 1.67 meg. Okay. So there's on pin 3. And you can see it doesn't really change much to do with the oscillation when I put the sponge on there. That is because there's that big series resistor. But take a look at what happens when I put my probe on the diode. I'm in DC coupled mode right now. So right now I am about 2.6 volts. And if I put the sponge on, drops down to about 1.3 volts, which is sort of what we were seeing before, right? When I was using the multimeter. And actually, even residual moisture on there does affect it. So that's kind of interesting. So I think that's about all the damage I can do right now on the workbench. I'm going to take these guys outside tomorrow and stuff them in the dirt in the garden and see what they show me. Welcome to the garden, testing time. So I'm going to plug each one of these things into the dirt in turn and just see what I find. So that resistive one is showing 490-ish right now. And the capacitive one, I'll just jam it into the dirt right beside it. I'm putting them both down to the line. So it's coming down, 350, 390. And just for comparison, I'm going to use this commercially available one that my wife uses for her potted plants as well. It's got three different modes. We'll just leave it in moisture mode right now. And it, let me just zoom that out a little bit here. It looks like it's resistive, yeah, as far as I can tell, and it's going between these two probe tips here. I'm going to jam it down into the ground, kind of in between those two. So you can see all three at once. So it's showing sort of about 30% or so between the dry and the wet. And the capacitive one right now is showing 298, 300, and the resistive one is showing about 520. So that's kind of about 50% mid-scale. That one is relatively low. If we completely take it out and clean it off and just put it up here where it's dry, it's going up to about 870 or thereabouts. Okay. If we dry, if we take this guy out, it pops right back up to 1020. Okay. So it is, they are all showing that something is changing when you plug them into the dirt. So they're doing their job. What do you think? Do you approve? Okay. He didn't find anything wrong with my experiment. So that was interesting. It actually, this capacitive one especially, reacts quicker in real dirt than it did with my sponge test. So that's interesting to know. And this guy always responded quickly to everything, the resistive one. But it is reasonable to note that they all performed quite well in a real world situation. So that's cool. And then there is several things that I could do to calibrate them further if I chose to. And if I'm going to deploy these, and especially this one, in a real world application, I probably do need to calibrate them better. One thing that I've seen suggested is to calibrate them using both the driest conditions you can come up with and also the wettest conditions, which is obviously going to be just in pure water. I'm not going to go through the whole thing But basically, let's just see what this one does if I have it stuck in directly in pure water. 185 or so. Okay, so I could set that in the soft air as my zero point because it's never going to get wetter than that. Then that would be a reasonable calculation. And maybe instead of setting 1023 as my high point, set 100 or 100%, right? Well, I guess for completeness, might as well test the resistive one against pure water. Well, I'm going to guess that it's going to go pretty much to 100%. But you don't know until you know. And then you know. Yeah, so that's going down to 200, 223, which is pretty much the lowest that I've seen it. I guess that makes a certain amount of sense. Yeah, so for a real application, I could probably scale both of those into a percentage, which would make more sense, I think. But I'm not at that point yet. This is just tinkering around with the sensors. There may be other soil moisture type sensors out there that I'm not aware of. I don't know. Do you know of any that I haven't encountered yet? Again, this resistive one is probably not the best long-term unless I can put some sort of a electrically conductive but non-water soluble barrier on it. Oh, I just noticed the tips on this thing. One of them has corroded fairly significantly compared to the other one. And one of the aluminum, are those? Yeah, those are both aluminum, I think. I don't know what the material is in these tips, but this one's discolored quite a bit, and this tip has worn down over the years. And this thing is not left in the soil ever. It's pulled out and wiped off after each use. Admittedly, it's probably about 10 years old. I don't think I want to do anything more on this right now. I'll leave it where it is. I'll think about packaging. I'll think about application. I probably want to use this one in a plant pot kind of a scenario. And what I might do is just come up with a 3D printed case for the board. Not sure whether I'll use that one or something a little bit less expensive just for a permanent installation. Could probably actually run this on an AT Tiny 85 like that guy's running on. Yeah, I think it should be able to do that. There's enough pins. And if anybody's got other sensors that they think might work for just monitoring a plant pot, let me know down in the comments. Thanks for watching. Any other questions or comments, of course, down below in the comment section. As always, I'm happy to discuss this stuff with you. Thanks for watching. Talk to you later.